Match of my life. Life stories and greatest games.
Radio City Talk.
Right, today's Match of My Life guest hasn't stopped smiling for a month. You would do if you'd helped Liverpool win a sixth European Cup. He's part of the coaching side of the team. And of course, when you're the goalkeeping coach, there's a fair amount of pressure on you. It's John Achterbeg. Won't you, John?
Good morning.
Great to see you. Yeah, that smile's still there. It's momentous stuff, isn't it? How are you feeling a month on?
It's a good feeling, know that you win something big with the club, but you always need to think ahead as well. So Saturday we start, and hopefully we can produce something good this season again.
That's a very professional outlook on it all. You've had 4 weeks in which, have you watched it again? Have you watched the final again?
I watched some stuff back, of course, the goalie stuff and the goals and stuff. So when you see loads of celebrations coming around as well in the end, no. So you see quite a bit back. You watch every game back, really, to be honest, on the stuff of the goalie. So you stay always on it.
At the start of the season, you set out to achieve an aim, which is to win something, don't you? And of course, there's only a certain amount of possibilities there. Now, given you'd got to a European Cup final last season, hadn't ended the way you wanted, is there something out of the disappointment that maybe drives you on in the next season?
As a coach and as a player, you always want to win, no? And I think that is a drive you have to have and always want to improve and be better. And I think winning something makes you hungry for more, in my opinion. And if you see after the game, the celebrations, the people in the town, because I saw on the telly they said 750,000, but what I saw was for sure more than 1 million people on the streets. So, you know, to see that inspire you, know, to do more, I think. And I think the players will think the same as the coaches, so hopefully we can do something more this year, and that's the plan, no?
John, is that the biggest party you've ever been to?
I would say yes, and there won't be many better, you know. I don't think you'll see many clubs in the world where they can produce this support, I would say.
When you're travelling around on the bus with the team, and I was lucky enough to do it in 2005, it's remarkable to be at the heart of something like that, and it really emphasises the connection between the club and the community.
Yeah, I you know, we had a few times where we had big games, and then you see the atmosphere around the stadium when they wait for the bus to come, and the support and the singing and the aggression. That gave you goosebumps. Then I always thought, and we were close a few times, that if we do win something, that it would go off. But I didn't imagine what I saw in on that Sunday. Like, so, yeah, that's an experience for life. But you hope to do it again and again. That's how it is, no?
Of course you do, because it feeds the appetite.
Yeah, that's it, no? So, yeah, we hopefully Saturday start again for the new season, and hopefully we can make something happen again.
What did the players and the manager, did you all talk about it after the parade? Did you all sort of say to each other, wow, I never thought we'd see something like that?
Yeah, something like that, I would say, yeah, it's an experience you cannot imagine. And Pete said, yeah, Dortmund is big, but I think he also realized that Dortmund doesn't come, I think, in my opinion.
Who said that, the boss?
No, the assistant, Pete.
Oh, right, right.
Dortmund is big as well with the support.
Yeah.
But I don't think they come close to what you had seen on a Sunday, because he said that in the start of the ride and not when we are back in town, you know. So I think it was for everyone a great experience.
Let's just rewind a bit then. So we'll go back to the start of the season. We'll talk about the Champions League in itself. And in all honesty, in the group stages, you lose three away games, and perhaps there is a little bit of a doubt. Maybe not in the coaching side, but I think as fans, you go, you know, have they got the ability to get to a final this year? It puts you in a little bit of a predicament, doesn't it?
Yeah, but that is football. No, there's always moments in a season that one moment can change that way in a positive way or the negative way. The confidence is always there, no? And yeah, we did play three away games. We lost. I think Napoli we didn't play well, but we lost in the last few minutes. Really, draw was probably fair, I would say. In Red Star, we didn't play well at all, to be honest. But, you know, we always have the ability to turn it around. And, you know, obviously then we had to win the Napoli home game, which was a really good team as well. And in the end, we win in the and we keep a clean sheet. Obviously, it makes the great save in the last minute, which helped to get us to the next round. And, you know, from that moment... We were getting better and better, to be honest. And, you know, the team got more and more into a rhythm and we were hard to beat. And if we would score one goal, we always had the feeling that that could be enough to win the game.
Belief is everything, isn't it?
No, that's true.
You talk about the massive save. So let's talk about the individual who's in goal, which is Alisson. And obviously, the club spend a lot of money on him, but it's obvious he's one of the world's best. So when he comes in, you must have been pretty excited, thinking, wow, what a great young talent to work with.
Yeah, that's true. That's, you know, the season he had is really good now, and he's still carrying it on at the moment in the Copa America, really.
Yeah, so Golden Gloves, Champions League winner, and now into the final of a Copa America.
Yeah, I mean, everyone can see that now. I don't have to tell about it. You can see what he has done, and I don't think there's not been many goalies this year who has came close to the level he had played, really, which is good for us, no? But obviously you have to do it as a whole team. The defense start up the front, the boys put pressure on the front with the front three, and then, you know, your defenders, they've been really good too, and that combination makes it probably a winning team, no? For Ali to come to the Premier League in his first year to do what he did, is really unbelievable, because it's not an easy league to play physical wise, and obviously there's always one or two moments what you can do better, but that's in every individual, you know. So, but if you break the record, clean sheets for the club, and win the Golden Glove in your first year, you're on a good way, I would say.
Give us an insight into his personality, because you know, when you're the goalkeeping coach, you spend a lot of individual time, don't you, with the goalkeepers, you know, to improve them, to help them mentally, drive them on, etc. Tell us about Alisson. What sort of person is he? Ultra confident? Is he just a really hard worker?
Yeah, he is really calm, but he wants to work hard. So I think as a goalie, you have to be calm, you know, because you have to make difficult decisions on the high pressure. So by being calm in your head and in your mind, you can make better decisions. So you need the kind of fitness level, because if you the fitter you are, your head is more calmer, and you're more fitter upstairs to make clear decisions. So it's a combination from everything. But hard work is always one, because if you don't work hard in training, you cannot perform, you know. So you have to be fit and be ready every game, and he has the mentality, but he want to work hard, and that's why we need to keep that going, that formula, if you like, and keep working with it.
I mean, you've played and worked with a lot of top class stars. Is he one of those sort of natural born winners? Is he one of those that you just know has got something special about him?
Yeah, you know, if you see how calm he is, and he gets frustrated if they don't win the game in training, you can see it on his face if he concedes. So it really hurts him if he lets a goal in, even if he can't do nothing about it. Or if the team could have done better, then he gets a little bit upset. So, but on that side, that's also learning to deal with negative situations. But he's working every day to the maximum he can.
Because one of the big things is when you move from maybe a Serie A and Roma, the football's very different, as you mentioned, isn't it? And there's bound to be a settling in period,
yeah,
and a different sort of demand on him to play the certain style of football that maybe Jurgen Klopp wants him to play.
Yeah, I think when he came, he said he likes to play football.
See that he likes to play it on the floor, doesn't he?
You could see that, and you can see that also that it's really calm. So that helped our team. Obviously, we had to work on that. There was always options available to play for him when he got the ball back, and that improved over the season also. We worked on things to improve him. You know, did work on the physical side. What can happen with the goalie when they play physical teams and stuff. So we try to help him on that way in the preseason straight away to try to make him ready. But yeah, in the game, you always have to feel it, no? Mm. And it costs sometimes a goal as well to feel it. And then he is clever enough to use it and, you know, overcome it. And that is football because, you learn by playing and different styles, use different techniques and different decisions. So, and I think he picked that really quick up because he's a smart goalie.
Well, you know, you've played at the highest level yourself, and as a goalkeeper, you could be hero or villain, can't your job.
Yeah, you know that is the situation of a goalkeeper, no? You always want to be the hero, and that always not comes off, but you can only do so much and try to overcome it by you always be working as hard as you can and be focused as much as you can. And you need to create a hunger as a goalie every time to set yourself targets. I want to be the best goalie in the league. I want to keep so many clean sheets. So you need to create a mentality yourself as a goalie to try to make the steps all the time and keep the hunger. The longer you keep the hunger, the longer you can keep on the highest level.
You mentioned individual moments can take you to a Champions League final and help you win it. And without doubt, the moment you mentioned before has to be held up there, which is Alisson Becker's save at the end of the Napoli game, which however many times you watch it, isn't a fluke. I mean, this is great goalkeeping, isn't it? Talk us through. I mean, you can't pre-plan that, can you? But actually talk us through the moment.
Yeah, the thing is, as a goalie, especially playing for Liverpool, you have to wait for that one moment save, you know, and you talk to in training about, always stay ready, you know, keep yourself warm in the game, even if you have nothing to do, stay switched on because you need to make that one save. And I think he on that moment, he is instinct. He sees what happens, and it's like a no-win situation. But then he tried to do something to make it a win situation, and he done it a few times this season. On his game reading and intelligence, he is really decisive. And then,
but you got to make that decision in a snap second, haven't you?
That's it, you know, and that is where he's good at. No, he reads the game and he has no fear, if you like. He decides and does it, and you cannot buy that. That's natural, if you like.
This is what your boss had to say. So Jurgen Klopp said, "I've no words for that Alisson save. It was a lifesaver. I'm really proud. It wasn't just one save. Alisson had a lot of things to do tonight. How cool and calm he was with the ball coming for cross is outstanding. But that save was really incredible." Is that, without sort of pinpointing one moment, if you look back at this season, and he's made lots of good saves, but is that the biggest of the moments that Alisson's been involved in?
It kept us alive in the Champions League at that moment. But
you don't win it otherwise, do you?
No, we're out. That's how it is, no? Because they score, we're out. That's how simple it is. But again, you cannot take it as the whole team performance away as well, because you need the whole team to perform and we all fight it to get to the next round. Yeah, and obviously that moment in the last second, that turns the game because otherwise it's done. Mm-hmm. But we had this kind of moments before, you know, but as if you, from a goalkeeping point of view, Barcelona, we need to keep a clean sheet at home. And, you know, we did it as a team. And obviously, yeah, he made a few good saves in that. And there'd be more games like that, you know. But if you play for Liverpool, you sometimes have that one shot. And then that is a quality to make that save. And yeah, he seems to have that quality.
Right, fantastic insight into goalkeeping at Liverpool. We'll talk the Barcelona game and Madrid very shortly. John Achterbeg is my special guest today on Match of My Life.
Match of My Life.
At Liverpool goalkeeping coach John Achterbeg, my guest for Match of My Life today. We're discussing just how good Alisson's been throughout the course of the season. But as you've rightly said, that sort of depends on how good the team is as a whole. I would imagine, you know, Alisson's looking at Virgil van Dijk in front of him, player of the year for most people. Matip, who's had an exceptional season, and then Andy Robertson and Trent. And he's thinking that this is built perfectly for me as a goalkeeper, isn't he, John?
Yeah, that's how I feel it. And then you obviously have still, you know, like Joe Gomez, who had an injury, and Lovren has played some part too. So it's really important if your defender's in front, also in the right positioning, makes your positioning easy. Because if they defend in front, you don't have to protect the whole goal. You can only, you take the angles of them and you have to only defend half. If the cross comes in, if the ball goes over the two top fellas, then there's a good chance it only can be lofted over them. And then it's a chance for the goalie. If you have a small centre half, it get fired with power, then it's a difficult ball. So the height of the two centre halves dictate a little bit on the crossing sides too, you know.
Yeah, and without overly picking out individuals, it helps having Virgil van Dijk in your side, doesn't it?
Yeah, I think, you know, everyone talked a lot about him, and he was also probably one of the best players last year, you know. And hopefully they all can keep continue what they've been doing, and we pick it up another gear with the whole team, really.
Is there any additional work behind the scenes between the centre halves and goalies, or is that just a natural bond that they create on the pitch on a match day?
No, the boss obviously trains the tactical side always for every game, and then you have the combinations dealing with crosses and free kicks and corners in the training. So then there is a communication between the defenders. You do playing attacking football defensively, so in your tactical training they always work together, so they learn to bounce off each other, if you like, and pick the right positions off each other. So that's where the boss works always on with them.
You must feel exceptionally lucky to be part of the setup there. You talked about the boss. What sort of influence has he been for that football club, because you've managed to see it at close quarters?
Yeah, you can see the progress, I would say, over the years. Know how many finals he got us through, and the style of the boss. He makes it a team, you know. He gives them the half-time tactical information if it's good or not good to make the next step. But you can see it on the sideline. He fires the team on, he fires the support on. You know, he makes a lot of the difference, and I think he showed it before he came with Dortmund, and he carries it on. Only I think, in Liverpool is more possible with the owners. They're getting the money for the boss to get more players, so we have a good squad, and the boss then makes it a top squad by the way he works them. And
but it's not easy, that, and without doubt he is one of the very best in the world, isn't he, that we've got?
Yeah, I would say from what I've seen.
Yeah,
I think, you know, he makes that team spirit perfect in the club, around the club, the bonding with the supporters. You know, I think it's not only me recognized. I think everyone can recognize that. No,
and I would presume he's one of those who is never willing to give in. So, if we go from that to the Barcelona game and the away game, and losing 3-0. But actually, a scoreline that felt really unfair because Liverpool were outstanding and probably outplayed Barcelona in the Nou Camp. I was there that night watching, thinking, how on earth is this 3-0?
Yeah,
you need strong characters.
Yeah, no, that's true. And the boss is a winner. No, you can see that in everything. wants to achieve things and win every game and win things as well. So for him, it was great to win because he's been close a few times and now actually he got it so that's great. Yeah, if you talk about the Barca game, I was sitting on the bench, really. You know, we're gonna score any minute. That's how it was. No,
it felt that way, didn't it?
In the first 10 minutes, we could have scored 2-3 and it could have been over. But obviously, how it panned out, it was really a knock, if you like, because we played that well that we could have had a draw at least. If not, you know, you think if you lose 2-1, you still had a good chance, or even if 3-1, you think it's a chance to do it. When you go 3-0, then you think, oh, it's going to be really tough.
4-0 would have been out of sight. And of course, Dembele misses an opportunity at the end, but Alisson has to keep alert at that moment.
That's true, no? But yeah, in the end, we 3-0, we thought we play all or nothing, if you like. Mm. And then they got one or two chances and, you know, we got away with it, really. And yeah, like you said, that happened. And then obviously we have to go into the home game. Boss team talk, he said it's not an easy situation. That's the truth. No, he said, and there won't be many teams who can do it, but if there is one team who can do it, that's you. But then you have to believe it all and all be switched on and go for it and work as hard as can and even harder than you have ever worked. And I think
so. That was the team talk that night at home against Barcelona, and you'd have been in many team talks. Was that one of the most engaging sort of, because that night goes down in folklore now?
Yeah, that's true. I mean, he has a lot of them kind of inspiring team talks. You know, he really can inspire with a team talk the players. You know, and you think then, yes, we can do it, you know.
You wanted to walk through walls after you come out of the dressing room.
Exactly, you know. So, and that was one part of the message, you know, next to the tactical things, what we had to do and what you train for. And, yeah, then you do it. It's unbelievable, really, you know.
And, of course, you're facing the best in the world. And just to go back to the first leg, as a goalkeeper, you can't do anything about that messy free kick, can you?
No, apart from him diving.
And he
did it yesterday again.
Yeah.
And obviously Ali catch. I don't know if you watched it. It was a bit late, but I watched the game. It was half one this morning. But the free kick he catch, no. Similar way he kicked it, but Ali was quick enough to get to the ball. Yeah, and
you were shouting at your TV, were you, half one this morning?
No, I was not shouting, but I'm pretty calm when I watch. Yeah. But I think
you can't stop that free kick, can you?
Messi is special, no?
Yeah,
that's how it is, and he can produce special things, but also I think like yesterday for that free kick was a dive again, and you know. He should, with his quality, he don't have to dive, no. But, you know, people give him quick a free kick for this kind of situation. And that's what happened in that game, no. Obviously, he took it well and it was a great finish, but it was a no foul. But that's football, no. With VAR, hopefully, that will be cut out.
So the game comes back to Anfield. And, of course, the pressure isn't just on Liverpool to score four. The pressure is on the defenders and the keeper to keep a clean sheet.
Yeah, that's true, no? And they obviously try to create a little bit of angriness through the players. They tried with Robbo.
Yeah, Suarez was trying to ruffle it up, wasn't he?
And Messi with Robertson something. But the team stayed cool. They were focused, you know. And, yeah, if you 100% focus, then still something can happen, but the team did really well, and Ali made a moment, the saves needed. Yeah, as a goalie or as a defense, it's always this kind of pressure, you know. You need to keep a clean sheet, but it's also it has to be a focused job, if you like, you know. Always when you play, if we keep a clean sheet, we have a good chance to win. So that is your target every game, and I don't know if it's an automatic thing, but yeah, that's what you have to stick in your head, no? And you learn, if you have this kind of mentality in your head, you learn how to keep clean sheets. And I think that is what we have a big improvement in last year. As a defense, we can keep clean sheets and we can drag 1-0 out. And that is the massive change, I think, from the last few years. And then you always have the feeling we can win.
You're a bit like Jurgen Klopp. You like to show your emotions. So, yeah. You know, and that night, that was like a roller coaster that night. It was impossible not to get swept up in it, yeah. Wasn't it? So, you know, 1-0, 2-0, 3-0, 4-0. Goodness me. I mean, you guys were growing crazy like the fans, weren't you?
Yeah, that's true. But I don't know. It's like a pressure release also. No?
Yeah.
You know, you want to win so much. And you are calm, but then, yeah, when it happens, that obviously it's like you explode from happiness, if you like. And, you know, and then you have to be back calm and focus on the next thing and keep the momentum hopefully going and try to drag the game over the line by the team.
Hugely historic night, and of course there'll be lots of people who've been to many of the ones preceding it, Chelsea in 05 or St Etienne or, you know, some other great Anfield nights, Roma. I think that will stand out to a lot of people as possibly the one. How did it feel afterwards when you were on the pitch and you were all sort of lined up in front of the cop? Because they're moments that you possibly only get once in your life.
Yeah, that's true. And we had so many good moments, but that is probably the best, no?
Yeah.
You know, we didn't play great in the final, but still dragged the win off the line. But in the Barca game,
it was the final performance almost, wasn't it?
Yeah, that would have been an unbelievable magic if we would have done that in the final. But we needed this to make the final. So, you know, it was a complete bust because there was not a lot of people who thought we could do it. And if you then make it happen, yeah, that makes it a great feeling. And I think, like you said, a lot of people will think that was the best game at Anfield for a long, long time.
How did that feel, standing in front of the cop and sharing that as a full squad?
What can you say? It's also a wow moment, but also after the final on the Sunday, that is like the same kind of feeling, no? Hopefully we can produce this more, because that's what you want, no, as a player and as a coach.
Right, we'll talk about Madrid in just a moment or two. John Achterbeg, my guest today on Match of My Life.
Radio City Talk.
John Achterbeg, Liverpool goalkeeping coach, my guest this hour on Match of My Life. A final in Madrid against Spurs. Were you bothered whether it was Spurs or Ajax personally, John?
No.
You can say it now. It doesn't matter.
No. I was no. From a personal point of view, not.
Well, you know Ajax closely, don't you?
Yeah, but I'm from Utrecht, and Ajax and Utrecht don't go well together. So
it wouldn't have made a difference to you, though.
No, for me, it doesn't matter. You know, you just want to think about winning.
Mm.
We did the same the year before. So
perhaps the thing that a lot of people focused on was the fact that you've met Spurs quite a few times, and perhaps in the season, they'd been tough opposition, hadn't they?
Yeah, they're a really good footballing team. A really good team playing football. I always do feel confident if we play them. I don't know why, but we have had some positive results against them.
Mm.
But they're always hard, and we could see that in the game. No, they had some chances in that game too, and they always, physical-wise, they are really fit. You know, they play some good football, so you have to find the right way to play against them. And we knew it was going to be not an easy game. There's no easy game anyway. But with our experience from the year before, I guess
that does count for something, doesn't it? Getting to a final.
Yeah, it does. I think it's a learning. You know, over the years we got some finals, so the boys have more and more experience playing finals, and it does help. And you see that with Madrid, they had that experience at that time.
Mm.
We probably played in Madrid better maybe as a team and didn't win. And this time maybe not as good as we could, but, you know, it's all about winning, and that's what we did, and that's what's count.
Of course it was. You went out the day before, is that right? To Madrid, was it? Or was it 2 days before?
No, yeah, we did. We go the day before, yeah.
The day before?
Yeah.
And is that... does it become quite an intense build-up to a Champions League final?
Yeah, it's... I think it was maybe more intense the year before for the feeling because it was new.
Right, and you're facing Real Madrid and it's...
Yeah, but I think this time we always try to treat every game like the next game in the same way, you know. We worked like we usually work, you know, in terms of improving tactical, how to set up, what we do.
Just try and make it as normal as possible.
Yeah, that's true. And that's the same with the goalie training. You prepare them what can happen in the game in terms of what the opponent do, in terms of that kind of sessions you train next to the physical and fitness into it. So you do like the tactics for the game as a goalie training too. And as a team, you do it. So we didn't do anything different that way. You know, obviously we go to Spain for 1 week to prepare there to try to take the team away from the hectic in the town and stuff like that.
Maybe get them used to a little bit of heat, because on the night it was absolutely sweltering in that stadium.
That's true, you know, and that helped. It was more hotter the night of the final than the night before, because you could feel the difference in the shade and in the sun.
Mm.
But because the people are in, it keeps the heat in, really, and it was a lot hotter on the final. And that is not an advantage for the way we play, I would say,
no.
with the intensity.
Yeah.
And the way we press, so that's why it was probably later in the game also become a little bit harder. But we saw it out all right, I think.
You spoke about a rousing team speech for the Barcelona game. Did it have to be that way for the final or not? Was there any sort of really deep, meaningful words from yourselves or the boss in the dressing room?
I think on that side there's not a lot needed.
No, it speaks for itself.
Yeah, I would say it's more about what we have to do and how we have to do it, tactical-wise, in positioning and out positioning. And then obviously, you can make history, like the boss say, for all your friends and family, you know, and for yourself and... Yeah, for your kids.
That says it all, doesn't it?
That's the
something
truth,
to tell your grandkids.
Yeah, that's the truth, no? And I think, you know, for players like Hendo, it was great too, no? He'd been in a few finals and always works his socks off. And then also he get rewarded to win this, you know. For a lot of people like that, it's a great feeling, no?
Yeah, brilliant start.
Yeah.
You couldn't get a better start, could you?
That's true, no. That does help, because otherwise it would have been probably a different game. I think Tottenham probably would have liked to hold the defence a lot longer and sit back more and hope for the breaks. And now they had to change a little bit. And then it suited us probably better, although we didn't take the second... We were waiting for a second chance to take. We didn't create too many, but we still had them. And it took a long time before we get the second in the end. So then you know it's done, no?
And there he is, the man for the big occasion. Divock Origi, Everton, yeah. Barcelona, and a Champions League final.
Yeah, it's like...
You couldn't write it, could you?
It's like a cartoon, no? it's great for him, no, and to be fair, he has been working hard in training, in finishing and stuff, and yeah, if you put it in training and you always work hard, you always get somewhere rewarded, no?
Mm. And Alisson, of course, he did play well in that final, of course. There were saves in that second half that he had to make.
Yeah, he cut us through and make it look so easy, but it's not that easy because he made some great saves in that game and stay so cool. He really helped the team get through the game in that way and paid it off the salary and how do you call it?
The price, the transfer fee.
Transfer fee we paid for him.
Well, it's worth it, isn't it? Yeah. What do you do at full time? Whistle goes. What did you do? You run to Alisson? What do you?
Yeah, we ran to Alisson, but Simon was quicker. To be fair, I'm not that quick, but you know, Simon also to mention him. No, he had to keep working the whole season hard and be ready.
Real professional, isn't he?
He has been working really good, and always you never had a day where you thought, oh, Si is not on his game or not working or not ready. You know. Yeah, that's important too, no, to have someone like him there. And yeah, he has done a great job behind the scene too. And then we had the two young boys working day in, day out as well.
How do you feel when you know you've won the Champions League?
Yeah, what can you say? It's a great experience, great feeling.
You're part of a very unique band, though, aren't you? Yeah. There's only a few who've done it. You've got the medal with you, have you, today?
Yeah, that's what you asked for.
Yeah, no? Come on, let's have a look at it. Get it. He's just got it stuffed in his jeans pocket. Does it not get any special treatment? This medal's been around a lot of necks, I would imagine.
Yeah, because
since that moment,
because there was a lot of staff who didn't get it, so I give it to everyone to take a picture because you know, it's like the whole unit who did it, really. So I thought, you know, like the kitman or the girls in the canteen and the security, everyone is part, so I let them all take a picture with it because it's a team togetherness, no, we all work for it and we all want to achieve it, so that's how I see it.
John Achterbeg, does life get much better than this?
Well, if we can win the league and we do it again.
Now you get greedy, don't you?
No, yeah, but that is the hunger you need to have, no? Yeah. You want to win and you want to be the best and you want to keep driving. That's it, no?
Special times. And just to go back to the bus parade, just seeing the smiles, is that what it's all about? When you?
Yeah, that's amazing, no? But I realized when I started already that Liverpool was big, you know, when you go on to China and whatever, how much the support is, but then actually see it with winning something in the town is amazing, no?
John Achterbeg, thank you very much indeed. Match of my life guest today. Fantastic story and, of course, unbelievable achievement, a sixth European Cup.